Arno Harris, the CEO of Recurrent Energy.
Thank you very much, Dave, and thanks everyone for sticking around. I promise you we'll reward your patience and endurance with, I think, what'll be one of the more interesting panels as we discuss some of the really important issues facing us as we get ready to think beyond 2020. On that note, while the topic of this panel is getting beyond 2020, I think the truth is that some of the most important issues really have to do with how we're first going to get to 2020, because we've set ourselves some ambitious goals. So far, the rollout of AB 32 has been focused on the electric power sector. And the good news is that the success we're having in terms of achieving the goals in that sector have given us a lot of confidence about our ability to actually deliver a low-carbon economy. Getting to our 2020 goals is, however, going to take us into addressing other emissions from other sectors. And I think it's going to present other challenges as we attempt to make that move to decarbonize. This year, there's been a lot of discussion about how challenging or how expensive it may be to make similar progress on transportation fuels, which will come under the cap early next year. But the challenge is not just with transportation. As another example, the state's water challenges are clearly tied to the state's energy issues, and without doubt, making difficult decisions will be part of how we solve those water challenges and how we decarbonize our utility sector and ultimately how we solve for climate change. To address these questions, we are very fortunate to have with us a really illustrious panel of legislators, some of whom I think are very recognizable as longtime environmental leaders who have brought us landmark environmental legislation, and others who will lead this state down this path in the years to come. One note, we're short one panelist today. Assemblymember Perea was unable to join us, but I'm sure with the group that we have here, we'll have a very robust discussion. So let me first quickly introduce the panelists. In this room, it may not be necessary, but I think just out of courtesy, we'll give quick introductions and then we'll jump right into the issues. Senator Kevin de León, representing District 22, which includes downtown Los Angeles, East Los Angeles, South Pasadena, and Vernon. Senator de León, as many of you know, is now the Senate pro tem elect, and this fall he'll be taking on that role as the leader of the Senate. He is known for his strong record of environmental interests as well as interest in environmental justice, a great example of which is SB 535, a bill that I think passed 2 years ago, is that correct? And provided the framework for addressing how cap and trade funds could be distributed to disadvantaged communities to address the issues that emerge there. To his right, Senator Pavley, representing District 27, which includes Agoura Hills, Encino, Malibu, Sherman Oaks, and Simi Valley, Thousand Oaks, and Van Nuys. Senator Pavley chairs the Natural Resources and the Select Committee on Climate Change and AB 32. Her record reflects her strong commitment on environmental issues, and she is often referred to as the mother of AB 32. So we're very lucky to have her on this panel today. She also has a strong interest in economy, education, energy, environment, consumer protection, and in the context of this conversation, I think her background will be very useful and very informative. And last but not least, Assemblymember Mike Gatto from District 43, representing Burbank, Glendale, La Cañada, and Los Angeles. Assemblymember Gatto is the chair of appropriations in the Assembly, and his record demonstrates a strong interest in water issues, conservation and reuse, as well as consumer protection. So to get things started, let's begin with a discussion about a hot topic here in the Capitol, the scheduled inclusion of transportation fuels under the AB 32 cap and trade system. I think we can agree that the state has a vital interest in addressing the emissions from carbon fuels or from transportation fuels. They're a major source of carbon emissions, obviously. They're a major source of other air pollution that creates health issues for the state and imposes costs there. And they're also a source of really volatile expenses that are imposed on Californians' pocketbooks. So getting to 2050 requires us to demonstrate that we can address these issues. And in the previous fireside chat, I thought Mary Nichols did a great job of explaining why it was so important for a wide range of reasons for us to take this on now. But as a framing question, I think I'm interested to hear from each of our panelists about how we approach the issues posed by putting fuels under the cap. What is the best strategy for moving forward to reduce transportation emissions? And how do each of you think about optimizing the balance between carbon, health issues, and consumer cost impacts? And I think maybe we'll start here with Senator De León.
Thank you very much, Arno. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here with each and every one of you and the good folks at the Advanced Energy Economy. I remember I was here last year, you know, with Tom, and I think the focus last year was on energy efficiency and reducing our energy load, and the gargantuan victory that we had back in 2012 with Prop 39. But I'm really delighted to be here with two very good friends of mine, both Southern Californians, you know.
Dodger fans.
Both Dodger fans, for those, you know, who are Giants fans here, you know. We got our majority leader from the Senate, Lynn Corbett, who's obviously a Oakland A's or San Francisco Giants, yeah, Oakland A's, the working class team, you know, from Oaktown. But, you know, my very good friend, you know, Senator Francisca Pavley, you know, also known as Fran Pavley, but I call her affectionately Francisca Pavley. And my good friend, you know, Mike Gatto, obviously, as you said, Arno, the chair of the Powerful Appropriations Committee on the Assembly side. The idea of transportation fuels under the cap is not new. In 2006, when we had the landmark groundbreaking measure AB 32 by Senator Pavley and then Speaker Fabian Nunez, that was something that was quite earth-shattering for not California, not just the nation, but rather the whole entire world, given that the Kyoto protocols were in jeopardy, and I think a lot of folks, rightfully so, were somewhat pessimistic that any country in the world would move forward with any cap reduction goals in mind. So obviously with AB 32 in 2016, the scoping plan in 2008, cap and trade in 2010. So we're in 2014 right now. The transportation fuels are going to come under the cap next year in 2015. So this is not new. This is 8 years going on, and this is not a surprise. It shouldn't be a surprise to anyone. It is a little fascinating to watch some of the machinations, if you will. It is a little expected. It is somewhat predictable that there'd be, and it's fine to have an opposing, you know, a dissenting opinion with regards to what the transportation fuels may mean under the cap. But it's a question of fairness. We know that the IOUs, you know, the utilities have done a really good job with regards to cap and trade. But it's a question of fairness, having everyone under the cap, the biggest emitters, whether you're stationary or mobile. To sort of take the macro and put this in the micro, for example, my district, to give you an idea, I have seven major freeways that crisscross my district. And I like to say, I think I can say with great authority, that my district is probably the most diverse district, not in the state or in California, or I should say in the country, but rather on planet Earth, because I have Little Tokyo, Chinatown, Koreatown, Filipino town, Little Armenia, Thai town, Little Bangladeshi, as well as the largest concentration of Mexicans outside of the Republic of Mexico, and the largest concentration of Central Americans, Guatemalans and Salvadorans, specifically outside of Central America. So it's an amazing, rich mosaic of diversity. At the same time, I have seven major freeways that crisscross my district, the 2, the 5, the 10, the 60, the 110, as well as the 710. And those freeways are like a serpent that chokes the air out of the lungs of young children. And the number one reason for absenteeism in our public school system is due to asthma. Now, we got the issue of carbon, obviously, which is atmospheric, and the issue of criteria pollutants, both NOx, SOx, and particulate matter, 2.5. You know, I always joke with my friend, when I'll start off and
I know where it's going.
I'll refrain myself when I really get on my soapbox about this issue. But this is an issue that disproportionately impacts lower socioeconomic communities, particularly children, in these areas are much more vulnerable to both climate change and obviously, you know, traditional pollutants. And it has a really devastating impact on working class communities. Again, not just in my district, but in the Bay Area, Central Valley, and elsewhere. So having the transportation fuels under the cap is absolutely critical. It's predictable. We've talked about it since 2006. It's not new. Folks can have a dissenting opinion, which is perfectly fine. But this is one thing that I find quite interesting is that, and I find a parallel with regards to healthcare, not just ACA, but healthcare with regards to back in the day when then President Bill Clinton tried to move forward healthcare reform. Remember the commercials of I think it was Harry and Louise, and we had the very visceral sort of these commercials moved folks at a very visceral emotional level. With this issue with regards to potential price manipulation and with the volatile gyration and who's going to control the prices with regards to gas, transportation fuels in the near future and the impact that it has on the electorate up and down the state of California, but especially working folks, is going to be quite interesting to witness and watch and see because it is having an impact on a handful of members, no question about it, that serve it or whose constituents are by far and large a working class, Californians who would be disproportionately impacted by any price manipulation at the pump to sabotage, if you will, the transportation fuels under the cap. So this is a big issue that we're going to deal with. It's clear that we can't have a lot of volatility. It's absolutely critical. It cannot disproportionately impact working class folks. But it's a question of not revenue, but it's a question of fairness to have the biggest emitters of CO2, carbon dioxide, under the cap. Absolutely critical.
Indeed. Senator Pavley, in terms of thinking about this question of really, it's been raised by Assemblyman Perea's bill, AB 69, around whether we should, in fact, delay putting the fuels under the cap. From your perspective, do you agree with Senator De León that this shouldn't be a surprise? We've been talking about it for years, and it's urgent and important that we move forward.
I absolutely agree with the next Senate pro tem.
Important to establish that now. Yes.
It's just everything is wonderful that he said. No, but seriously, Senator De León's been a wonderful partner in the implementation of AB 32, and particularly brings a really strong and compelling voice on behalf of disadvantaged communities and to make sure that our regulations are relevant and beneficial to all Californians. And so I was looking at the three of us, we represent about 2.5 million Californians. Mm-hmm. Critically important, we all happen to be from Los Angeles area where just on the battle for decades with our Air Resources Board, who has fought many of these same battles, if you look under the Clean Air Act and over the decades, with the same kinds of people that are concerned about what the regulations might mean. But how successful the Air Resources Board and the federal government under the Federal Clean Air Act have been at really making amazing progress in cleaning up our air. If you lived in Los Angeles 40 and 50 years ago, before you, Mike, 40 and 50 years ago, you couldn't go outside and play at recess at school. You had red flag days. You had to spend the time indoors. We're doing some amazing things, and so every time we look at a particular challenge at the time, and this time it's fuels under the cap, I think you have to step back a little and think about how did we implement things and move things going forward? Has it been a benefit or not? And I would say our clean air standards and regulations as implemented, and I'll throw in the clean car law and everything else, have been a benefit to society, have not destroyed the economic opportunities of California, and in fact, perhaps have saved people an incredible amount of money in healthcare costs. Can we do better? Absolutely. Do we have to make these rules and regulations relevant and beneficial to all Californians? We are from a very diverse state, absolutely. But if you look in this room, 12 years ago, I've been in office since 2000, you wouldn't have had a room full of businesses who are financially doing extremely well because we're creating markets for innovation for the 21st century, sustainable businesses for the future, and providing several hundred thousand new jobs because of clear market signals. I'm concerned about delay by the market signal it sends to investors. People are heavily investing in the diversification of fuel, different kinds of fuel supply. Frankly, it's healthy to have that competition of fuel supply. I know the oil companies can be investing and have been in the past in developing alternative kinds of fuels, reliance on oil, especially dependence on foreign oil. We know it's bad for our economy, but it's certainly bad for our planet as well as our national security. So I think delay is a huge problem. Oil prices are set, as we know in this room, globally. The up and down of the volatility of the oil prices are always going to be there. When I was in office, oil was, if you went to the pump, it was $2.15 a gallon. And believe it or not, the rise to $4 a gallon wasn't because of AB 32. And fuels weren't even under the cap. So it is volatile. How can we minimize that risk to consumers? Because we're concerned about that. Heavily investing in clean freight in the transition for trucks, especially independent truckers, into having cleaner fuels or cleaner running engines, more efficient engines, providing opportunities for all income levels to have access to cleaner, more fuel-efficient cars. There's something wrong when people that are on fixed incomes, the only car they can find at the auto dealer is the 10 mile per gallon huge gas guzzling SUV, and that's the last thing they need because it's depleting their limited source of income that they need to feed their family, et cetera. And heavily invested in transit. You know, what's been really exciting about looking at the expenditure of auction revenues and implementing these policies is we're seeing a real renaissance, if you will, in public transportation. LA is even building subways and things like that, and light rail. So getting people out of the car, that minimizes the volatility of the risk of any kind of gas prices going up. Primarily, gas prices will go up because we haven't diversified our fuel supply. We're doing a lot better job right now in our utility sector. I was around during deregulation where we were gained by Enron, out-of-state energy companies. Now we're heavily investing in renewables. Many people in here have profited from that clear market signal that we haven't wavered from. And the prior panel was quoting, I believe, Warren Buffett or it was George Shultz. It's really George important Shultz. Yeah. To stay the course. Yes, adjust it if there are problems. And I feel very comfortable with legislative oversight. CARB looking carefully at how their programs are implemented, that if we need to make adjustments along the way, we will, but delaying, for the sake of delaying, is problematic, and the real cost will be not investing in transportation, and it's the health care problems that will result to millions of Californians like live in our area. So delay, in my opinion, is not an option and going in the wrong direction.
Indeed. Assemblymember Gatto, I want to make sure that we give you a chance to weigh in on this issue as well.
The assembly always goes last, folks. That's how it works.
That's why we run for Senate.
First of all, good afternoon, everybody, and it's an honor to be here. If I had known in advance how large and illustrious the crowd would be, I probably would have shaved a little closer and worn a nicer suit. And some of you might laugh, but I borrowed that line from Kevin de León, who I believe used it this morning at a similar panel. I know Assemblymember Perea is not here today, and rather than putting an empty chair on the stage and trying to have a back and forth, I did want to just talk a little bit about some of the themes that I know he would have touched on if he was here, and just give you my perspective from some of the broad themes politically, because I think that's the type of insight that you're all here to hear us provide. First of all, the difference between Henry Perea and Mary Nichols. Well, I know you're saying, oh, there's a difference of opinion, but the primary difference between Henry Perea and all the people who signed the letter that he authored and Mary Nichols is that they are elected to office. A lot of the people, you know, obviously who staff these executive branch agencies like the ARB, they are appointed officials. They never answer to the voters. But every day when Henry Perea drives home to his district in Fresno, when I fly home to my district in Los Angeles, and everybody else on this panel flies home, we have to answer to the public who got us here in the first place. So when we talk about the broad themes about the future of this law, and I know there's lots of people in the room who care about the future, or more accurately, these regulations, when we talk about these broad themes, we have to always remember that politics is best described as the art of the possible, right? Every issue, when you look at it, you have to look through the lens of what I call the four P's. There's the policy, is it good policy? And hopefully that is the guiding light when you look at any issue. But then there's also the politics. What do the politics say? You know, who's on both sides? What do the different special interest groups say? How are they gonna affect the debate? There's the people, because the people, of course, matter a great deal in this state. They matter in our form of government, and they can at some times rise up and demand a change. And there's the press. If the press seizes on a theme and it becomes a meme and it's something that continues, it will affect how the people think, it will affect how the elected officials think. So you look at this issue, you know, in that lens, yes, we might, in the room, we might recognize that the price of oil is something that is set by the world commodity markets, but do the people of the state understand that? Some do, some don't. When they know that these regulations go in effect and they see a rise in the price at the pump, will they, accurately or not, will they blame policymakers? Well, they can't vote Mary Nichols out of office. But you know who they can vote out of office? They can vote out Henry Perea, and they can vote out me, and they can vote out Senator Pavley. They won't ever vote her out because her district, actually she's termed out of office. But two and a half more years. but that is the tension, folks. That is the tension, folks, that we are seeing. And I will tell you that it will not go away. If you look at what is dominating the federal debate right now, it is this concept of executive power versus legislative power. I mean, John Boehner is talking about suing the president for these decisions made by the executive branch and by executive branch agencies versus decisions that are made by the officials who are elected. It is no coincidence, I think, that those who are on the ballot every 2 years, who represent the smallest districts, these are at the federal level members of Congress and the lower house, and the state level they are members of the assembly, that these are the officials who are most vulnerable to some of the more, in the four P's I talked about, to the people's will and things like that. I think that is no coincidence, and I don't think that will ever go away. So I guess the message that I would say, that the theme that I would give is that if you care about these regulations surviving, if you want them to survive because you believe in the policy, the first P, then you have to do everything in your power to try to control some of the debate, you know, when it goes to the other issues. Because, you know, if the price of gas spikes and the press picks up on it, and that's the story that's on the nightly news every night when people turn on the TV, and people start tying it into these regulations, it will not matter what the truth is. That will bend popular will to such a degree that the decision makers that have to answer to the people will want to act. And that is what you are seeing now. And you know, I think it would help if some of the people who staff the executive branch agencies were a little more, I don't know what the opposite of arrogant is, but that is really, really key for making sure that this debate is not something that gets out of our control, and that it's not a debate that is moderated primarily by fear, but that it's one that's moderated by reason. So, you know, I mean, again, we're up here because we're lawmakers and we're trying to give you the sense of how things are operating in the political sphere. I think this theme is, you know, a couple things. You have to recognize it's not going to go away. It's going to be here. It's going to govern things for the next 5 or 10 years. You're seeing it at the federal level. You're going to see it at the state level. And there are things that everybody in this room can do to make sure that logic and common sense govern it versus other things.
Senator De León, you wanted to respond?
Let me say a couple things. One is that I can appreciate Mike's perspective. Mike has a pragmatic, you know, lens because these are real issues, what we talked about with regards to depending what happens with the volatility of the market and how gas will be priced out at the pump, which is something that's real and tangible for consumers up and down the state of California. And as Fran had just mentioned earlier, she was here, I wasn't here, during the dereg of the electricity market and how it was gamed by Enron. And we saw some of the criminal indictments that followed because of the price gouging and the manipulation of the market, especially in the spot market. So these are really issues that we do have to deal with and confront. Henry Perea, I know him, we all know him, and he is a very thoughtful legislative leader. He's a very intelligent legislative leader, and he represents a very important part of the state of California, the Central Valley, a lot of ag business there. Area that's also home to some of the worst air pollution in the entire country. So how we do this, we have to do this very intelligently. And there's always been, and Mike's described this tension, and it's always good to have tension. It's always good to have healthy tension between the legislative branch and the executive branch. I think it's always good to have some healthy tension between the two branches. With regards to climate change and criteria pollutants, it's not just the nation that is watching California, but the world is watching California. The entire world is watching California. And how we move forward with the auction revenues in the cap and trade scheme is going to be absolutely critical in terms of verifiability, how we can quantify and we can measure actual real carbon reduction goal, our carbon reduction goals, and move towards a low carbon economy. It's absolutely critical, and that's why I think, you know, AEE is so critical, because even the name AEE, you know, is very different. It's very different, you know, advanced energy economy, because how do we reduce carbon emissions at the same time we can create jobs that are real and tangible and move forward an economy that is actually growing in the state of California and therefore throughout the country, throughout the world. We just got back from Mexico. And it went with large delegation. The governor and I had several private, smaller meetings, and with the president of Mexico. They had just last year, the year before, developed their frame for their carbon reduction goals. Two issues that predominated our trip in Mexico, especially in the smaller private meetings with the Secretary of the Economy, the Secretary of Foreign Relations, as well as the president of Mexico, two issues, the main issues. We talked about a lot of issues. The two main issues that predominated were the children, the undocumented children at the border, specifically, and climate change. Those were the two issues. How do we regionally, in our own Western Hemisphere, counterattack in a collaborative, cooperative way, you know, the devastating impacts of climate change? And quite interesting, it seems like our friends south of us, south of the border, may be more progressive than other states in our own country when we talk about climate change. You know, one of the Nobel Prize winners and chief advisors to the president of Mexico, Enrique Peña Nieto, is Dr. Mario Molina, you know, who won the Nobel Prize on climate change, and he's at the University of California at San Diego. So he's had a major impact on the president. And that is a big issue, how we do this regionally. China, India, and other countries are watching us on the cap and trade, because we have advanced so far, more than anyone else in the country, in the world, I should say. And how we do with cap and trade is going to have a major impact, I believe, on climate change globally, because the Chinese, again, are watching us in India. And the critics are correct in that we can't do it alone, because we're not an island unto ourselves. China and India and everyone else is going to have to join in with us ultimately. But the incentive is for economic growth. Obviously, we've emitted God knows how many metric tons of CO2 that advanced our economy, that makes us the world's most powerful nation in the history of nations. Other folks want in the game, and they say, well, we got to emit our share of carbon too, you know. But we know if they do, the reality is that the earth is in peril. So how can we do this and balance the needs and keep prices down in terms of what Mike says is a very pragmatic approach dealing with prices at the pump. But the issue with regards to what's been happening in Washington, D.C., and it's really exciting what's happening in California, because we've witnessed John Boehner can't control his own folks. You have folks who are willing to take this country over the cliff, you know, and you have folks who predominate in Washington, D.C., in the House of Representatives that are not even skeptics of climate change. They're climate change deniers altogether. Even if you have all the empirical evidence and data, a panel of Nobel Prize winners in front of them, they will continuously, you know, deny that even it exists. So that's how dysfunctional and how backwards Washington, D.C. is. And that's why we can't depend on the feds or look towards leadership, innovation, anything that's cutting edge. They look towards us in California. And it may sound California-centric, but again, let me just underscore and emphasize, the nation is not just watching us, the entire world is watching to see how successfully we move forward and execute our cap and trade program.
Indeed. So I think it's important to point out that all of you up here are people who care about the environment, all of you people who care about consumers and care about the needs of disadvantaged communities. I mean, this is not a question of sort of one side or the other, right? It does strike me as having very similar resonance to the conversation before California implemented the RPS and before we started in with AB 32 on the power sector, which is there was a conversation that sort of bounced between fear and optimism. And the fear on the one hand was this question about cost and the unknown that it represented versus, you know, the hope that AB 32 or the RPS would stimulate new activity that would result in jobs, result in new businesses. And, you know, we are sitting here in this room in a state that now is leading the country and in many ways you could argue is leading the world in how to actually convert the issue of climate change into a message of optimism and an economic engine. I guess rather than continuing sort of in a debate between, you know, the question of expense versus the question of you know, hope, are there other solutions here, right? I mean, the argument on the fear side to me seems to boil down to just a classic argument about regressive expenses and how they impact disadvantaged communities at a higher level. But there are many different tools sort of in the toolkit to deal with that kind of disproportionate impact. And I know Senator De León, you've authored a bill, SB 1275, which attempts to sort of take that conflict in a way in a more positive direction. And I believe Senator Pavley, you've signed on as a co-author. But that might be a way to explore the idea of other solutions to this apparent conflict in thinking about how do you target additional support to disadvantaged communities. So maybe, Senator, you could explain what 1275 is.
Just in 30 seconds, and let my fellow panelists, I just spoke for a while. 1275 is a measure, and I'm working together with Charge Ahead. And the goal and the objective is to put 1,000 ZEVs, zero, you know, electrical vehicles on our roads, but in particular in communities of a lower socioeconomic status. Obviously, we know that electrical vehicles are targeted and marketed towards coastal communities, communities that have a higher income, higher educational attainment, you know, but in Boyle Heights and MacArthur Park, East Oakland, Bay Hunters Point, Richmond, Santa Ana, Logan Heights, where I grew up in San Diego, obviously electrical vehicles are not pervasive. So the question becomes is how can they be part of the low carbon economy and how can we incentivize through cultural modification, behavioral modification, individuals so they can participate in the low carbon economy and thereby reduce their carbon contribution. We're excited about the bill. We're working with car manufacturers. Obviously, they're a little in a tizzy, especially for those who drive Teslas, you know, and the question becomes, you know, I mean, if you drive a Tesla and you can afford to, you know, to drive a Tesla, should you receive, you know, an incentive from the state of California, you know? And that's a big fundamental question that we should ask. It's a fair question to ask We want to keep Tesla here in California. One of the biggest champions for Tesla, especially with the battery plant, is our majority leader here, Ellen Corbett, who fights fiercely for them, you know. But it's a big philosophical question that is fair game to answer, you know. But we want to incentivize folks of the lower economic strata to get into electrical vehicles, not just these large gas guzzling vehicles that disproportionately impact, obviously, climate. But it's an important bill.
What makes California relatively unique compared to other states is our major contributor to greenhouse gas emissions is from mobile sources. And so it's, you know, one of those all of the above strategies. And so that's why fuels under the cap and access to cleaner vehicles, investment in transit and getting people out of their cars and bike lanes and everything. And we're working very hard in order to make sure this kind of world is achievable for all of California. I wanted to go back a minute because this is sort of like the conversation we had 12 years ago when California's clean car law, I was a freshman legislature at the time, was passed. Oil companies were opposed. The automobile manufacturers sued for 5 years to block it. Auto dealers, what would happen to your car? Your prices would go up on your cars. You wouldn't be able to, no one could afford to buy them. You can't make people drive alternative fuel cars. And there were legal challenges all over the place, whether it was a preemption of the Federal Clean Air Act. Took a Supreme Court decision. We finally got a waiver and it was implemented. So fast forward today, look at the car market from 2000, right? Foreign and domestic automobile manufacturers. I mean, it was a real concern that the domestic automobile manufacturers would be put out of business because they couldn't want to compete in this more fuel-efficient car market that the foreign manufacturers were taking away from Californians. But you look at it today, and it's amazing to me that all these major foreign and domestic automobile manufacturers not only had invested in hybrid as a transitional fuel, but alternative fuels, hydrogen, electric cars are exploding and everywhere, and they save more money at the pump and it's lowered their financial risks by investing. So our big goal to myself is how do we make sure that those kinds of fuel efficient vehicles that are good for the planet, reduce dependency on foreign oil, help clean up our air, are achievable for everyone. And whether it's through clean transit, natural gas buses, or whether it's other kinds of personal passenger vehicles, we need all of the above. But we're seeing a renaissance. And so we went through the concern and the fear 12 years ago when we were making this transition. Sometimes transition is hard. We need to be sensitive to it and adapt if we need to along the way, but I know we can do this.
I want to make sure we could speak, could probably spend another 30 minutes talking about this issue, and I think the important thing here is really that it does seem to me that there are other answers, that delay is not necessarily going to really solve any of the questions that are coming up there, and that in fact by addressing through the programs you guys have talked about, there are mechanisms to address this issue that are more productive and keep us on course. I do want to make sure that we spend a little bit talking about the energy and water nexus. There's an oft-quoted metric that 20% of California's energy ends up going into moving or treating water. So obviously there's a huge overlap there. And the key to reducing carbon usage is going to be reducing that energy load associated with moving all that water. You know, conversely, fossil fuel plants use water both to make steam but also for cooling. With the impact of climate change, we have a lower snowpack. That means we have less hydro and less water for all those other uses. And finally, you know, the drought we're experiencing right now obviously makes this issue very urgent and very fraught. Assemblyman Gatto, you have a bill that is addressing water usage and reuse. And I'm curious if you could tell us a little bit more about what your bill, AB 2282, does and maybe help us understand its connection to energy.
Sure. So I think most people in the room do know that statistic that 20% of the energy usage in California is used by moving water. It's not just, for the Southern Californians in the room, so you don't feel too guilty, it's not just conveying the water from the north to the south, but it's also pumping groundwater, you know, in places in the Central Valley and in Northern California. Very, very energy intensive, uses a ton of energy, puts out a ton of greenhouse gases. Of course, then the question becomes, what can we do in the realm of water to make sure that, you know, in that realm, we are seeing the connectivity to the greenhouse gas problem. I'm a big fan of recycled water. I mean, you know, I ran a bill last year that said any new car wash has to use recycled water. That took effect this year. Any new car wash that's permitted has to have a recycled water system. It obviously doesn't make sense to be taking the dirt off that dirt-encrusted Jeep from a weekend of off-roading with drinking water. It's just terrible use of water. It actually ends up being more cost-effective for the car washes too, because the technology is so good to strip the detergents out of the water and strip the dirt out of the water and reuse it in a loop that their water bills go drastically down. And that obviously is something big, and that was something I did last year. This year, I focused on two things. One of them is making sure that our building standards for new houses, that they reflect the ability of recycled water. You know, if you were planning what we could do to make, you know, humanity have an impact on, you know, on greenhouse gases, it wouldn't necessarily be buying a new, you know, electric vehicle. It would probably be living closer to where you work, buying a used Honda Civic, taking it out of the garage on weekends, and, you know, using as little water as possible. But for those people who, you know, where we're building those houses in parts of the state that are very arid, and we're putting these huge lawns on those houses, you know, which is a reality, and it's an unfortunate reality, shouldn't we, especially in municipalities that have a vast recycled water capability and they have vast recycled water reservoirs, shouldn't we at least be marrying the supply with the demand? Should new houses have a third pipe, not just for hot and cold, but also a third pipe for recycled water, so that if that homeowner understands that they're paying, you know, whatever per gallon for drinking water, but it's 10 times less for recycled water, that they will use that to irrigate their lawn, that they will use that to wash their car, that they will use that to do their laundry? I think the answer is yes. And so my legislation would say that the building standards in California have to reflect that, that, you know, new construction where recycled water is available should have a third pipe coming in for recycled water. Another bill that I'm, and the senators are asking about it, so hopefully they're excited, and hopefully this means that it might actually pass the Senate. Oh, good, good. I like to hear that. And then another bill that I have, which hopefully addresses the low-hanging fruit, would implement a program of loans for businesses and for homeowners who want to do water efficiency upgrades, because I mean that's still low-hanging fruit. Southern California has done wonders with reducing our water use, but in the rest of the state and in Southern California, there's still more to be done. If homeowners can get a low-cost loan from the state to retrofit their premises, if businesses can do the same, I think it'll make financial sense. They'll use less water, and it'll help us in the long term. So hopefully I was. Unlike the senators, I left some time for my colleagues to talk. I was going to suggest
that.
Hold that bill.
My bills are dead, folks.
I was going to suggest that at least just in paying some sort of at least lip service to the title of our panel, which is to think beyond 2020. So far, I think we've thought about 1 year ahead. Can each of you share your thoughts with us about what it is you're looking at when you look further down the road? What are the things that, from as a legislator, you think are important for us to address in order to really take the steps we need to decarbonize our economy? And I think maybe out of deference to Assemblyman Gatto, who complained earlier that he went last, we'll let him.
Oh, great! I get the toughest question with the least time to think about. Decarbonize our economy. I mean, look. I think anything we do, lawmakers deceive ourselves to think that legislation can change everything. It can't. You need cultural changes, you need attitudinal changes. I liken it to what happened in the 1980s with drunk driving. You know, before the 1980s, and despite what Senator Pavley, you know, she flattered me earlier and said that, you know, I might not remember some of this stuff, but I remember that, you know, back in the day, if you were caught drunk driving in certain cities, the cop would say, you've had too much to drink, promise me you'll go straight home, go on your way. How much have attitudes changed about drunk driving? It took a crisis. It took a huge uptick in drunk driving deaths. It took community groups forming, Mothers Against Drunk Driving. That community group changed the world. It took legislation. It took people cracking down on people who drink and drive. And then it took, all of this stuff snowballed into societal and attitudinal changes. That's what it's going to take. It's going to take us cracking down on people who are carbon hogs or the worst emitters. It's going to take community groups being involved and being partners with us. It's going to take high-profile legislation showing that we can change the world. But none of this is going to happen with just one of the groups doing it without a partnership. And that's why, you know, earlier on, I know I said some harsh things, but I meant to spark that type of thinking, because I don't think one agency can do it by themselves. I think they're going to need the buy-in of the public. They're going to need the buy-in of the press. They're going to need the buy-in of legislators. And I think if we can have all these groups working together in a sensible way, we really will get to that low carbon or no carbon future that we all want.
So Senator Pavley, I think you're facing a 2016 deadline. Do you have a list of things you want to accomplish between now and then?
I always have long lists going all the time. Drives my staff crazy. Moving the ball forward, you know, back in 2006 and AB 32 passed, we could sort of envision 2020. You could sort of understand the RPS. We had things in place, clean cars. How do we move forward? What are the things? I think water is really a critical part. It is part of the scoping plan, but how do we have the metrics to quantify reductions of GHGs in water delivery and supply? I think there's some real opportunities there. We can incentivize districts maybe through, if you can quantify reductions through some expenditures of auction revenue, absolutely critical. I think staying the course on some of our policies, creating that strong market signal, absolutely critical for investors. I mean, I've been so excited about the economic opportunities now in California for this next generation of kids coming out of college. They're very enthusiastic about the future. Mike, you've been a great leader on building standards, but standards and appliances, we need to keep ramping up. I think local governments are a key to all this too. Not only the private sector, but the public sector and local governments. A lot of these great ideas are coming from communities all over California who are trying to be have amazing sustainability records, and they're saving money, plus creating more livable communities for their constituents. So there's a lot of opportunities. How can the government send the right market signals, but provide some funds or incentives to leverage better outcomes for all? And so I always look for those win-win opportunities, you know, of healthy environment and a healthy economy. I think California's poised to do just that.
It's an exciting time for sure. Senator De León, I think you may be facing a end of term limit as well.
How do you think? A long time.
You have a little bit longer time, but I guess as you're thinking about where to go from here and how we make that path to beyond 2020, 2050, what are the things that are on your mind?
Well, I have a lot of things, but you know, just a couple of things that just come to mind is I think that I'd like to help with the frame that advancing our economy, growing our economy, and a better environment are not mutually exclusive. In fact, they're quite compatible with each other, and they're very inclusive. One of some of my immediate short-term goals was the creation of a green bank for California, so we can attract and we can deploy the necessary capital so we can meet our low-carbon goals, smart grid, advanced transportation, energy efficiency, renewable energy, obviously wind, solar, solar photovoltaic, because ultimately we want to wean folks off grants and subsidies and let the markets come in. And we have to send up some strong signals out there so we can de-risk, if you will, the loans, so we can energize folks to get into the market. That's one of my immediate goals, because ultimately the taxpayer subsidy is not going to be sustainable, completely. So we're going to have to do a lot of de-risking and finding these types of schemes. So attracting and deploying this type of capital is absolutely going to be critical in the process of trying to find out how I can get the capitalization, if you will, by looking at certain inefficiencies, if you will, that currently exist with a whole variety of types of programs that exist out there right now. What works, what doesn't work, collapse it, we find some capitalization, some seed money, obviously from cap and trade dollars too. And you know, I can't stress this enough that, you know, because of the severe dysfunction in Washington, D.C., and the lack of leadership, and regardless of the next presidential election, I don't want to be presumptuous or partisan here, but even if it is a Democratic administration that comes in, that is my hope, you know. I think things will be very, very difficult nonetheless still in Washington, D.C., and the dysfunction will continue. Hence the pressures for the president to sort of move forward with executive decision making, because it's just not going to happen legislatively for the lack of cooperation and collaboration. Therefore, California will still continue to maintain its progressive position globally, and I believe strongly that it is California that will engage China more so than Washington, D.C., even though it's under the purview of State Department, foreign relations, so forth, et cetera, going to Mexico and being in the presidential residence and dealing with the Secretary of the Environment. California is the play in the game for them. It is not Washington, D.C., other than issues like drug cartel, immigration, and border issues. They are clearly looking at us as California as a leader. We will maintain that leadership role well beyond all of us here, because ultimately the goal is to have a better planet and a cleaner and safer environment for all of our children and future generations.
Well, that's a great note to end on. I hope all of you have enjoyed this discussion as much as I have. Please join me in thanking our panelists for their leadership, for their service, and for taking the time with us today. Thank you.